Thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here, and I would like to say that I have as a lot of people working in general relativity, I have the big book of Yvonne Choquet-Bruha, and it's amazing how at each time I start working on a new subject related to general relativity, I find in her book a pioneering work she has done in this particular subject for each, I don't know, everything related to general relativity I'm interested in, at least. in this talk, I wanted to start by presenting two different works of Yvonne Choquet-Bruha. The first one about the construction of a high frequency wave that Thibaut presented this morning, but I will represent it once again. I think it's worth it. And a second one, which is about the global existence of solution in U1 symmetry. And then at the end, I will present a little work I've done in collaboration with Jonathan Luc, where in fact we saw that the U1 symmetry, in fact, is a very good setting to study the high frequency waves. Okay. So the first part will be about a paper of Yvonne Choquet-Bruha that she wrote in French. So I will write the title in French. Construction de solutions radiatives approchées. It was a work from 1969. So the context of this work is so there is first some work by physicists on high frequency wave. Notably by Isaacson. And also some work on the emergence of geometrical analysis in the math, in the mathematical side analysis, and WKB approximation of solution to a partial differential equation. The WKB approximation consists in looking for solution with an amplitude function which is slowly evolving and a phase which is highly oscillating. So this is amplitude and the phase. And I will already give the theorem of Yvonne Choquet-Bruha from 69, which is the following. So
the notation lambda, or
sorry?
1/lambda.
One over lambda. Let's say, to be coherent with what I will write after, let's put omega. So it's really the notation of her paper. Omega, and omega is large. Okay. It's omega is large. So, our theorem is the following. So, a metric G, which can be written under the form G bar AB plus 1 over omega VAB of x and omega phi plus 1 over omega squared w of ab on x and omega phi. Here x is a space-time space-time variable. It's not a space variable. X is before t and x. Is the solution is an order one approximated solution to Einstein vacuum equation. Meaning that, which means that with the formal computation, which means that if you compute the Ricci tensor of this metric, it is a big O of 1 over omega. If the following conditions are fulfilled. First one, phi is isentropic for the metric G bar, which means that phi satisfies the Econile equation. Isotropic. Ouais. Isotropic. Isotropic. Hmm? Is isotropic, ok. And V satisfy propagation linear propagation equation. Equation along the ray of phi. And also some polarization condition. These polarization conditions are very reminiscent of the one you can obtain by looking at gravitational wave in the linearization of Einstein equation around Minkowski. Transversal to so let's write it. On an hypersurface which is transversal to the ray of phi. This. Which means, in other words, that the component of V are non-zero on if you write your metric in the coordinate adapted to d phi, the component of v are on the one which are orthogonal to the ray of phi. It can be written. It can be written. If I called theta, this variable, the fast variable. This can be written that, so, p alpha of d theta v equals zero, where p alpha is, so, d lambda v phi d theta v lambda alpha minus 1 half of d alpha phi d theta v lambda lambda. This. And also another condition is that W is a solution of equation of the type P alpha of two derivative of W with respect to the phase variable theta is equal to zero. No, is equal to something prescribed in terms of V and the J bar. So, function of V and the J bar. And last but not least, G bar should satisfy not the vacuum Einstein equation, but the Einstein null dust equation. Which are R AB bar, so the Ricci tensor of G bar equal something, E bar d alpha phi d beta phi, where E bar so can be written as so the integral of the function of x and t and the phase variable theta integrated with respect to theta, so the mean of E, where you have a formula for E. It is I don't have room here, so I will put it. And E is one fourth of d theta v lambda mu, d theta v lambda mu minus one half of theta v lambda lambda. So you have an expression for E. Okay. So I will comment on this result, which I think was really in fact maybe not so well known, but very strong result, and with a lot of potential for for future things. So. So first, a technical comment. This uses a variant kind of can see that uses variant of the wave coordinate coordinates which are called the radiative coordinate. But if you don't know what they are, it's not very important for the discussion, but otherwise it is. Something very important that Thibaut said this morning, it's that it shed light on the weak null structure of Einstein equation in wave coordinate or in radiative coordinates. And it was maybe quite surprising, in fact, that that it worked like that. So let me explain you what is surprising, in fact, in this result from at first sight. So if you look at a model problem for Einstein equation, the most simple model problem, D'Alembertian of U, D'Alembertian is the wave operator, equal to dtu, something with a quadratic nonlinearity, as in Einstein equation. And you look at, you want to do a development similar to the one which is written above. Okay? So you write u equal u naught plus 1 over omega f of u and omega phi plus okay. So and I want to show whether it is an approximate solution of this system. Okay. So I can compute so box u is box of u0 plus so I will have here I will have term of size omega if when I apply the box I derive twice with respect to the fast variable then I have omega and I have d theta squared of f and I have the so in fact I have the Econal equation on phi. So, so if I add this, so I can okay. And the order one term are when I derive this, I have so I can derive once with a fast variable and once with x. And once with respect to the space-time variable x. So I have d d beta f, and I can have also something where I derive twice, I derive once with respect to the fast variable, and then I derive phi. So I have box phi theta f. Okay. And now if I compute, and then the other term, in a formal calculation, there will be big O of 1 over omega. And now if I compute the right-hand side, dtu, dtu. I will have dtu naught, dtu naught. And I will have terms which are cross-product between dtu naught and term where I have which will be big O of 1, where I've derived f once with respect to the fast variable. So I will have dtu0 dt phi time d theta f and I will have term which will be dt phi time d theta f squared. So now, if I want comment je vais faire pour avoir mon tableau bio? Oui, c'est ça, oui.
C'est pas ça, c'est ça?
Non, ça c'est un pointeur, non?
Non,
c'est ça. Ok.
C'est bon.
Je vais aller sur la couleur. So if I look at my calculation, if I want to have an approximate solution, then if I need phi to satisfy the Econal equation, because I don't want term of size omega. Omega is big. I don't want. So I recover this condition. In the case of Minkowski metric, the flat case, it's dt phi squared equal gradient of phi squared. And the order one equation will give me some equation for d theta f, a transport equation. Transport equation for f prime is d theta f, which is a transport along the ray of phi. But this equation, a priori, is non-linear because I have the term dt phi squared theta f squared, and I should also add also the term prime plus 2 dt u naught. Dt phi f prime. But because of this, it is non-linear. Okay. So in fact, to be very precise, in this model, if I want this to be an equation for f prime, I should remove the average. Otherwise, there is no hope that this could be d theta of something. Okay. And so then the average would appear on the equation for u0. So in this, so this is only a formal calculation, but in this formal calculation, you can make a comparison with Schuckebrüher's theorem, and in a way, it explains you where all these things come from. You recover in this model, you recover the fact that phi is isotropic. You have a transport equation for f. And u0, the solution you perturb there, is not solution to your the equation you study, box u0 equal dt u0, dt u0, but it is a solution to box u0 equal dt u0, dt u0, plus this, time, dt phi squared. Okay. And this look like a lot. The Noldust equation. Okay. But there is something which is very different, in fact, between this model problem and the theorem, is the fact that the equation for f in this simple model is nonlinear. So this model. The transport equation for f is nonlinear. Okay. And so we can look at a second model problem, which would be instead. Instead, we can consider a wave equation with structure. And if you consider a wave equation with structure, and so you do the same, exactly the same analysis, but the difference is that all the dt phi squared, they are changed into q of d phi d phi. And if this is zero for isentropic phases, if q is zero, then the transport equation is linear. And the quadratic form which satisfies this are the null form.
I'm a little bit confused. So you have f prime is theta of f. So this looks like a linear problem to me. The transport equation that you...
So you have a transport equation for f prime. Here you have f prime squared.
So you're talking about the f prime. Okay.
For f prime. F prime is d theta f. Ouais. Then the transformation. On this condition, this is satisfied if Q is a null form. Okay, so if Q is a null form, then you have a linear transport equation, but on the other hand, you don't have back reaction. This term does not appear. So what do we learn from this discussion? We learn that the Einstein equation in radiative coordinate, they don't have the null structure because there is back reaction, but they have a structure because the transport equation are linear. Another very nice feature also is that the...
You're talking about in harmonic or in wave coordinates.
Wave coordinate. The thing is that in the Choquet-Bruyat work, it's not exactly wave coordinate that you use, it's radiative coordinate, but in wave coordinate, it's the same.
So this is an effect of the coordinates, you could say.
Yeah, but it's really the same. The structure which appear in this analysis, in fact, is the weak null structure of wave coordinates. Which really is
a... But it's a coordinate. It's a coordinate dependent phenomenon. That's what I'm trying to say. It's not.
It has to be investigated, but.
No, it is not. I mean, the end result. Actually, she does not work in wave coordinates. She insists that you get the wave, the harmonic condition as a consequence of high frequency waves. You don't need it. She works in a general wave, non-wave coordinates, in her paper.
It's a condition that she...
That derives from the Einstein equations. If the thing is non-trivial, you need isotropic. Okay. If it's non-isotropic, it's a gauge effect. If it's isotropic, it's not a gauge effect, and you get the variation of the harmonicity condition as a polarization condition as a condition for Einstein's equation.
But
continue. I'll continue on commenting the result. I wanted to emphasize the structure that that appear on the, which is very, in fact, makes the Einstein equation very particular in the class of quasi-linear equation, quadratic quasi-linear equation. So I have to erase the theorem. So there have been some subsequently some work by Burnett in 1989, where he considered more generally sequences of solution G lambda, which converge strongly to a metric G0, but whose derivative are only bounded, so they converge weakly in some LP space for P to be determined. Then, with solution to Einstein vacuum equation, then the Ricci, so we conjecture that the Ricci tensor of that G0 should not satisfy a priori the Einstein equation, the Einstein vacuum equation, but instead it should satisfy the massless Vlasov equation. So here it describes a fluid which is described by its density in space-time and in phase space. It's massless. It means that it's supported on the vector which are isotropic, and also F should be transported along the geodesic generated by P. So in fact, it is in total accordance with Schuke-Bruyat's theorem, but it means that more generally, you may have several directions of oscillation, and by integrating them, you obtain a massless. This is a generalization of an null dust, but with a lot of direction of oscillation. And also, we mention some so that this result is a this work is a formal computation in fact, but which sheds light on the structure of the Einstein equation. And let me mention a work by Arthur Twatty, which justify simplification of this approximation by constructing exact solution to Einstein equation, Einstein vacuum equation. With a development which is the one of the solution of Choquet-Bruhat, plus a remainder and a good control of the remainder, which allow him to say that this give the construction of Choquet-Bruhat are in fact so approximated solution to Einstein equation, but by adding a remainder, they can be transformed into exact solution of Einstein equation. And also, there have been also, so I am juggling between the year because it's 89, it's 22, and then go back to the work of Choquet-Bruhat. There have been some also extension to matter modal. But Thibault mentions them. So in particular, to the interaction of gravity with electromagnetism and of gravity with a fluid. Okay. So now I will start my second part, which is about the U1 symmetry. I will be a little more quick on this part. And this the work I will talk about are joint work of Yvonne Choquet-Bruhat with Vincent Moncrief. And they consider solution, so consider manifold of the form sigma time RT. Enfin, let's put the space together. RT times sigma times U1 with a metric of the form. So 3 plus 1 metric of the form G2 plus 1 plus E to phi dy plus A alpha dx alpha. So you can conformally rescale in fact this metric if you want.
Square.
Square, ouais. Consider. So metric like that. And in fact, you can do the following remark that Einstein equation in 3 plus 1, if the metric, importantly, is symmetric with respect to the coordinate in U1, so with respect to U1, then the vacuum Einstein equation is 3 plus 1 reduced to a system which is in fact a wave map system in 2 plus 1. So d nu phi, let's put the character, d nu phi plus, so you have to introduce something which is called the twist potential associated to the one form A. And so you have a wave map equation, which is a system of two wave equations with, this time, a true null structure. So this, in fact, corresponds to the null form of the metric G. And what is nice is that this system is now on RT times sigma, where sigma is two-dimensional. And in two dimension, in two plus one dimension, you have something which is called the elliptic gauge. That I will not, I don't have really the time to describe, but in which the Einstein equation. The Einstein equation in this gauge are elliptic. And the theorem of Fouquet-Breuer and Moncrief is a global existence result in their global existence result when sigma is hyperbolic and compact, so compact of genus greater or equal to 2. So in the expanding case, so with expansion, so meaning that the mean curvature of the constant T surfaces is 1 over T with expansion and under some smallness condition at the level of the metric in H2. So this the proof of this theorem is purely with the energy method. What makes the energy method work in H2 is the wave map structure. Okay, and so this is already at the level of local well-posedness. For the local well-posedness in H2 with energy method, you need this wave map structure. And the global existence goes thanks to the expansion. On the 1 over T, we recover this. We give you some decreasing of the energy. Okay, so.
Right, so the equation of omega, the last term is d beta.
It's five. Okay. So I wanted to finish with by speaking a little of joint work with Jonathan Luck about the construction of high frequency solution of Einstein equation with U1 symmetry. And what really I want to show to you today is why this U1 symmetry is perfect for studying this problem. And that's it. Solution with U1 symmetry. So first, let's look at the simpler model for Einstein equation with U1 symmetry. I have wave equation for phi, and so elliptic equation for g. And let's try the formal computation of in the spirit of Yvonne Chokebola. So phi, like phi zero plus a lambda f of of x and so let's be coherent, 1 over omega and omega. So now phi is already written, so now the phase will be u. Some gymnastics compared to the problem. So plus and so the if I want phi to be an approximate solution of the wave equation, then I will obtain the condition that the phase u is isentropic and linear propagation equation for f. Okay, but what is very nice is now if I look at the equation for g, I will have dt phi zero plus I will have cross term f prime dt phi zero dtu plus the term which will be dtu squared f prime squared plus big O of omega. So let's consider something in fact simpler, and that is very nice that we are allowed to do that. In fact, instead of this, I can make some separation. I will write my approximate solution as f of x times the cosine of omega u. Okay. And f prime, so then f prime is a minus sign. And here f prime squared is sine squared of omega u. So it is 1 half plus cosine of omega u, of 2, sorry, 2 omega u. And so it means that g in my expansion. Minus? If you wish. If you wish, put minus. Okay, let's put minus. Okay. And so.
Sorry? There is an f square also
involved. Is there an f square? Yeah, an f square here and an f squared here. Yes. F and f square. Okay. So here I have terms which are not oscillating, which will be, so I will be able to write my solution as g equal g0 plus oscillating term. What is very nice is that because g satisfies an elliptic equation, these oscillating terms are of order 1 over omega squared already. It's already the second order development in the metric, and it is what is very nice. Okay, so I have 1 over omega squared, and I will have term of the form something, okay, time sinus omega u, yes, plus term of the form something time cosine of 2 omega u. Okay. And g0, the equation for g0, I have so dt phi 0 squared plus f squared dt u squared. Okay. So really, it's in this setting, you can really do what Yvonne Chokebruha did, but in a way which is this time really independent of coordinates, and where you can make a separation between the term which oscillates with the factor 1 over omega and the rest which has a better behavior. So this setting is very favorable not only to do what she did, a formal computation, but also to construct exact solution. And moreover, it allows very easily is to consider the superposition of high frequency wave in different direction. Okay, so maybe I will just finish by saying a theorem. Maybe I will try this blackboard that if I'm allowed to be on this side, it will be here. So first, so this theorem is Jonathan Luck, one from 17, which says that every small local in time and regular solution to Einstein equation in U1 symmetry coupled to a finite number of null dust can be approximated by vacuum solution. But in fact, this really can be understood as you can construct an approximate solution, which is a sum of n wave, n gravitational wave oscillating in different direction. And conversely, every sequence of solution G lambda of Einstein vacuum equation in U1 symmetry with a rate of convergence of the form rate of convergence which is compatible with this kind of assumption. Converges to a solution to Einstein-Vlasov equation. So in this setting in particular, it answers the question you asked this morning. Because in this setting, it means that that every oscillating every sequence of oscillating solution in this sense in U1 symmetry converges to solution to Einstein equation with a right hand side. This right hand side is the energy momentum tensor of a Vlasov field. Massless Vlasov field, but in particular, it satisfies dominant energy condition. It is trace free, but in fact, it's stronger than that because it's a massless Vlasov. Okay. So, thank you very much.
Okay, so thanks a lot, Cécile, for the talk. Any questions?
What do you know about the solution that you get in the limit? I mean, about its regularity?
So, In fact, it's a little. I write a very non-precise statement, but in fact, in the hypothesis here, in the hypothesis, I assume that my limit is smooth. That I assume that I have a sequence of something on G lambda which converges, in fact, to a smooth. This converges to a G zero, which is smooth. And I have been a little loosely here because it seems that you should put G lambda minus G zero. At the first order, it matters. Afterward, not yet.
Concerning the existence of the twist potential, are there global topological constraints for the metric to admit omega? I forgot, no?
I don't, just know that it's true if sigma is compact of, okay, true, and if it's asymptotically flat also. In a stronger topology, I don't know.
So if it's an axisymmetry, for example, not a, a compact U1, but...
In this kind of reduction, I think you have an equivalent. Yeah.
And you can write the equation, but
you have an equivalent formulation in axisymmetry. Yes, that's been used in the proof of the stability of Schwarzschild, this formulation. Sorry?
Your theorem holds also in that case. You don't have an assumption.
I think it would hold, yes, with axisymmetry instead of U1 symmetry. Yes, I guess it would hold also. But this result is very local. So very locally, U1 symmetry or...
So you don't care that phi diverge at all?
Yeah.
If you have axisymmetry, is it regular on the axis?
I don't know. I said that it would be the same, but I don't know. Okay.
Axisymmetry would have two symmetries, no? I mean, here Guillaume was thinking of just a single Killing vector.
Yeah, but he's also right. There is only
axisymmetry
one.
Axisymmetry is one
thing. No, you have the rotation symmetry and translation along the axis.
No,
and you have a similar reduction. If you consider Einstein metric in 3 plus 1 with axisymmetry or with translation symmetry, you have the same kind of reduction that appear. Okay, but
You replace the translation by the
axis. You have the regularity on the axis that you have to.
Yeah.
Or maybe if I'm allowed to mention something else that I forgot to say, but I think it's important for other extension of the other problem. In fact, the reduction with U1 symmetry that I've written here. It has been also studied also by Yvonne Choquet-Brua for Einstein Maxwell equation, for instance. And what Einstein Maxwell equation with U1 symmetry, it's reduced to Einstein equation coupled to a wave map, but with more not two variables as here, but with more variables. And so, four. But you have also maybe four. Yeah, okay. With four. And if you want to study high frequency solution to Einstein Maxwell, you can also take this setting of U1 symmetry and in fact adapt what we have done for this wave map with two variables to a wave map with four. In fact, it doesn't change the analysis, and it's also a way to study Einstein-Maxwell equation, if somebody wants to.
So it's robust for any type of non-linear sigma model, what I call whatever kind of term with the number of scale.
Yeah. As long as you have the this structure.
Yeah, the structure.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
By the way, if we go back to the formal level of Yvonne's approximate solution. Mm-hmm. Is there an obstacle to putting waves with many directions, or one can conclude from her analysis by putting an integral over the light cone that I can put?
So it's I think it's because,
Why you have now an Alfred which is more general. So what allows you to do this now?
Because there you can just add things very easily. In 3+1, you can add, and in fact it will hopefully be done very soon by, in one sense by Arthur and in the other sense by Jonathan and us, that it can be adapted to more direction. But it's a lot of it requires more work because the polarization conditions are not as easy to sum up than.
At the formal level, it's not.
Yeah, even at the formal level, no, because you need some. In fact, there is additional structure which is needed in order to do so, but which is here, but which has a cost, mm-hmm. calculating cost.
And also, you lose the elliptic gauge that you mentioned, I guess. Without the U1 asymmetry, you wouldn't have the elliptic gauge.
No, you don't have the elliptic gauge. But with Arthur Ward, for instance, so you see that there is some kind of equivalent with, in fact, with the polarization condition and that are a little reminiscent of the elliptic gauge. But yeah.
Other questions? So let's thank Cécile again.